हेलो डियर स्टूडेंट, लेट्स डिस्कस सुपैक गाइडलाइन दैट इज स्कैलप एंड पोस्ट अप्रूवल चेंजेस। लर्निंग ऑब्जेक्टिव, स्टूडेंट शुड एबल टू अंडरस्टैंड कंसेप्ट ऑफ स्कैलप एंड पोस्ट अप्रूवल चेंजेस। Now when you have to follow this SUPAC guideline, if you applied for the NDA application, then scallop studies you have to perform and then go for the large batch size production. Now second case is generic drug product. When you applied for the generic drug product or the ANDA application, when patent is expired, after expiration of patent you can manufacture that particular dosage form after expiration of the patent, but for this purpose you have to show the bioequivalent studies, you have to prove the bioequivalent studies of that patented formulation and your formulation to the FDA, then and then only ANDA application is approved by the FDA. Again you have to proceed for the scallop and large batch size. Okay, these are the two types of the application, that is NDA application and ANDA application, and third is the AADA, that is the antibiotic application for the Now SUPAC is not a regulation but only the guidance. Why this guidance is required? It releases only to drug manufacturing and it's only available for certain dosage form. These guidelines are available only for the immediate release solid oral dosage forms like tablets, capsules and soft gelatin capsules. Then for the modified release solid oral dosage form including delayed release, extended release and topical semi-solid dosage form including creams, ointments, suspension, emulsion and gels. For these type of the dosage form you have to follow SUPAC guidelines. That being said, it's a very valuable tool in scale-up processes and the guidance does reflect the FDA's current thinking. This guidance defines level of change, recommended chemistry, manufacturing control tests for each level of change, in vitro dissolution tests, in vivo bioequivalence test for each level of change, and documentation that should be submitted to support the change. Okay, clear about which type of the dosage form you have to follow these guidelines and which type of the record you have to maintain. Now we'll see what exactly this SUPAC in process of developing of new drug product. The batch size used in earliest human studies are small. Means actual, during the actual approval process batch size is small. The size of batch is gradually increased and this increased batch size is known as the scallop. The scallop process and the changes made after approval in composition, manufacturing process, manufacturing equipment and change of site have become known as scallop and post approval change. In suppose we have applied for the NDA application or ANDA application and after approval of your application you want to change some composition of your dosage form, then you want to change the manufacturing process, then any equipment, or you want to change the manufacturing site, these things you have to change as per the SUPAC guideline. Then scientific rationale, why, what is the rationality of these guideline? To expedite the process of post approval changes of drug product, means to speed up the post approval changes of the drug product. Then FDA can assure their safety and effectiveness. Means if you follow this guideline, safety and effectiveness of your drug remain as it is. Means if you want to change a slight change in your preservative and you have followed SUPAC guideline, means there is no any effect on the safety or effectiveness of your formulation. Then it also lower the regulatory burden of the industry. For this purpose, we have to follow the SUPAC guideline. Now, these guidelines or the SUPAC changes designated as SUPAC IR for the immediate release solid oral dosage form. Then SUPAC MR for the modified release solid oral dosage form. Modified release means either you have to sustain the release or you have to modify the release profile of your tablet, and for this type of the formulation you have to follow the SUPAC MR guideline. Then SUPAC SS guideline. These guidelines are followed for the non-sterile semi-solid dosage form like creams, ointments, gels, lotions, and this was published in 1997, while SUPAC IR guideline published in 1995. This guideline defines level of change. Now, which type of the level of changes are there? Minor change, moderate change, and major change. Depending upon the level, depending upon the how much change you want to do in your process or in your manufacturing of your dosage form, that you have to categorize into the minor, moderate, and major change. If you when you go through this level of change in detail, then you will get idea which change should be considered as minor, which change you have to consider as the moderate, and which you have to consider as the major. Then test performed after these changes, that is application or compendial test you have to perform. Then in vitro dissolution test or in vitro release test you have to perform. Then in vivo dissolution as well as bioequivalence test you have to perform after these changes. Then you have to file those changes in which document? Either it is annual report, then changes being affected into the supplements, and third is the prior approval supplement. Okay, three type of the filing you have to maintain. If this change you have to report into the annual report, then into the supplement, and third one is the prior approval supplement, means previously approved application. In that application or in that supplement you have to mention this change. Then level 1 change, unlikely to have detectable impact. This level 1 change may be filed in an annual report and have no detectable impact on formulation quality or performance. If it is level 1 change, it does not have any effect on the quality and performance of your formulation. If it is level 2 change, have a significant impact on your formulation. They could have significant impact on the formulation quality and performance, and thus filed in a changes being affected supplement or prior approval supplement. This test and filing depend on the therapeutic range of your dosage form. Then solubility, permeability of your dosage form. Then level 3 type of the changes also having a significant impact on quality and performance, and others filed into the prior approval supplements. This test and filing documentation vary depending upon therapeutic range, solubility, permeability of pharmaceutical product. Now this guideline provide recommendation for post approval changes in. Means which type of the changes you have to consider change in the component and composition of your dosage form, change in the site of manufacturing, then scale up of the manufacturer and manufacturing process and equipment. If you want to change these four things, then and then only you have to follow the SUPAC guideline. And this SUPAC guideline again categorized into IR, MR and SS, that is immediate release, then modified release and non-sterile semi-solid. This is all about the concept of SUPAC. Thank you.